Metformin acts primarily by inhibition of gluconeogenesis in the liver. When hepatocytes uptake metformin, inside the cell metformin inhibits mitochondrial respiratory chain complex 1, and this results in decreasing ATP levels and in increasing AMP levels. To explain this, its mitochondrial outer membrane, its inner membrane and its intramembrane space. On inner mitochondrial membrane located electron transport chain that is composed of 4 protein complexes and coenzyme Q. And also there is 5th complex called ATP synthase that has its own unique function. The general concept here is that protein complexes in electron transport chain use the energy that is contained in electron to drive hydrogen protons from mitochondrial matrix to intramembrane space. This hydrogen movement occurs at the level of complexes 1, 3 and 4. The major idea of this hydrogen transport is to lower protein concentration in mitochondrial matrix and to increase hydrogen proton concentration in intramembrane space. These processes result in creation of hydrogen proton concentration gradients through inner mitochondrial membrane, with high hydrogen proton concentration in intramembrane space and lower concentration in mitochondrial matrix. And ATP synthase uses this concentration gradient and by transportation of hydrogen protons by concentration gradient into the mitochondrial matrix, it generates energy. And ATP synthase uses this energy for phosphorylation of ADP that results in production of ATP molecules. Also ADP produced by phosphorylation by ATP molecule of AMP molecule. Electrons are delivered to electron transport chain by mobile electron transporters as NADH and FADH. NADH is by far the major electron carrier. It's the most popular coenzyme for dehydrogenases, and NADH delivers electrons to the complex 1. So the concept here is that metformin inhibits complex 1. By this, it inhibits not only hydrogen movements through complex 1, but also electron transportation through entire electron transport chain. Thereby, hydrogen movements through all other complexes will decrease too. So this results in decrease in hydrogen proton concentration gradient, thereby the energy that ATP synthase generate will decrease, and this will result in decrease in ATP production. Thereby the conversion of AMP to ADP will decrease, and this will cause increase in amount of AMP molecules. And high AMP level activate adenosine monophosphate activate protein kinase, AMPK. What we have to know about this kinase is that it's important energy sensor that maintains cellular energy homeostasis. In case of energy depletion and the markers of energy depletion are high AMP level and low ATP levels, the kinase becomes activated and to maintain cellular energy, it stimulates catabolical pathways as glycolysis and beta-oxidation of fatty acids that results in production of ATP molecules, and at the same time it causes inhibition of ATP-consuming anabolical pathways as gluconeogenesis of fatty acid synthesis, thereby preserving ATP molecules. As a result, it increases cellular ATP stores, thereby correcting energy depletion state. So how AMPK inhibits gluconeogenesis? First of all, AMPK phosphorylates transcription factors and this inhibits the expression of genes that encode gluconeogenic enzymes as pyruvate carboxylase. So metformin causes decrease in pyruvate carboxylase level. And also AMPK inhibits mitochondrial glycerophosphate dehydrogenase that causes increase in cytosolic NADH level. To explain this, we have to know the glycerol phosphate shuttle. The concept here is that glycolysis generates NADH that carries two electrons. Recall that when glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized by glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, this reaction results in generation of NADH that in aerobic condition has to deliver electrons to electron transport chain in the mitochondria. But NADH cannot cross mitochondrial membrane. So in order to deliver electrons to electron transport chain, we have glycerol phosphate shuttle. Initially, dehydroxyacetone phosphate is converted by the enzyme cytoplasmic glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase that use NADH as cofactor to glycerol 3-phosphate. So basically, these two electrons now are inside the glycerol 3-phosphate. And then glycerol 3-phosphate comes to mitochondria, whereby mitochondrial glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme that use fat as cofactor, it gets converted back to dehydroxyacetone phosphate with release of FADH2. So these two electrons are now taken away by FADH2 that then delivers electrons to coenzyme Q, where electron transport chain use them in oxidative phosphorylation. And dehydroxyacetone phosphate comes back to the cytosol, where it can be used again as electron acceptor. And the principle of action of metformin is that metformin blocks mitochondrial glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme. Thereby, it causes decrease in dehydroxyacetone phosphate, and with decrease in dehydroxyacetone phosphate, cytoplasmic glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase do not have the substrate to oxidize, so NADH cannot give away electrons. So this results in accumulation of NADH in the cytoplasm. And high NADH level stimulates conversion of pyruvate to lactate. Recall that in gluconeogenesis, pyruvate is the substrate for glucose production. Pyruvate from the cytoplasm transported to mitochondria where pyruvate carboxylase converts it to oxaloacetate. Then oxaloacetate leaves mitochondria and in the cytoplasm phosphoenol pyruvate carboxykinase converts it to phosphoenol pyruvate that can be directly used in gluconeogenesis. And pyruvate can be generated by glycolysis or for example by catabolism of glucogenic amino acids that are degraded to alanine and alanine can be converted to pyruvate. Or which is by far more important, skeletal muscles during their anaerobic work by anaerobic glycolysis produce lactate that is uptaken by the liver tissue, it's a well-known Cori cycle, and liver is a major consumer of lactate because it can convert lactate to pyruvate and thereby liver can use it in gluconeogenesis. But this conversion between pyruvate and lactate can occur in both directions, and the factors that determine in which direction it will go is the ratio of NAD to NADH, because conversion of lactate to pyruvate requires NAD, and conversion of pyruvate to lactate, NADH. So the higher is the NAD concentration, the higher will be the amount of pyruvate and the lower will be the amount of lactate, and vice versa. The higher is the NADH concentration, the higher will be the amount of lactate and the lower will be the amount of pyruvate. And when patient takes metformin, first of all metformin inhibits gluconeogenic enzymes as pyruvate carboxylase, thereby it decreases gluconeogenesis and transiently causes accumulation of pyruvate. And simultaneously by inhibition of mitochondrial glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, it increases NADH concentration. As a result, it stimulates conversion of pyruvate to lactate, thereby it decreases pyruvate concentration, which is a substrate of gluconeogenesis, and also it causes significant accumulation of lactate that will exit into the blood and cause lactic acidosis, which is a signature side effect of metformin. And because lactic acid is eliminated by renal excretion, renal dysfunction can decrease lactate clearance and aggravate lactic acidosis. For this reason, before initiation of metformin therapy, we should look at biochemical analysis on serum creatinine level because it tells us about glomerular filtration function. So, as we see, metformin inhibits activity of gluconeogenic enzymes, it decreases the availability of substrate for gluconeogenesis, and simultaneously it increases the production of lactic acid that causes lactic acidosis that can be aggravated by renal dysfunction.